Started on our Sunday worship. Welcome to LIAC. Would you please rise?
of heaven, it is gone. Mercy fills the streets to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. And there will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. Every prayer we pray in desperation, songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, and in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. On that day, we join the resurrection, stand beside the heroes of the faith with one voice. A thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. On that day we join the resurrection, stand beside the heroes of the faith with one voice. A thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever he shall reign. Let it be today we shout the hymn of heaven. With angels and the saints we raise a mighty roar. Glory to our God who gave us life beyond the grave. Holy, holy is the Lord. So let it be today we shout the hymn of heaven. With angels and the saints we raise a mighty roar. Glory to our God who gave us life beyond the grave. Holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the Lord. And all will sing, holy, holy is the Lord.
Lord Jesus, we just thank you for the hope that is in you, Lord God. We thank you that there will be that day where everyone bows before you, where we praise your name, and all glory and honor belongs to you, Lord God. I
what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, in all of you be still. Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, and all of you be still. Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, in all of you be so. Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. When all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine.
You may be seated.
So I want to encourage you with these words today. We're getting into a season of Thanksgiving real soon. In fact, next week is Thanksgiving, right? And so there's nothing more appropriate to talk about than talk about gratitude and what we're thankful for, right? And so the Lord led me to this message on gratitude or attitude. Okay? And so that's what the Lord led me to speak to you on. And so we're going to pray and ask the Lord to guide us in this time and that he would speak to us very personally about this matter of gratitude, okay? So let's pray. Father, we come before you to thank you, God, for just being the God who is so loving, so gracious, and so caring towards us, Lord. Lord, even in the midst of us grieving loss and suffering and needing your comfort, Lord, you have always been there for us, God. I thank you for the way that you've been there for Pastor Al's family as they have been grieving the loss of Pastor Al's mom, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that her life is an example of what it means to faithfully follow after you, God. The lives she has impacted, oh God. Thank you for using her and how she has raised her boys, including Pastor Al, Lord. And I pray, God, you continue to bestow comfort upon this family, Lord. Father, we thank you for the way that you have also comforted the Ospino family, the J family, Lord, in their loss as well, God. We do continue to pray, God, in the days ahead, Lord, you will be near and dear to them, Lord. God, that they would be reminded, Lord, that Mrs. J is right now resting in peace in your presence, O God. So, Lord, we commit them to you. We thank you for this time that we can gather to worship you, Lord. I just pray, Lord, that by your Holy Spirit, you would speak to us, Lord. Speak to your people, God. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would minister to us. God, would you unpack these truths in your word? God, would you speak to our hearts, oh God? Help us, Lord, to respond to you with a grateful heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, church. I want to ask you guys a question. How many of you have been around grateful people? Raise your hands if you've been around grateful people. Okay. Aren't they fun to be around? Aren't these people great to be around? Like these grateful people? I personally like to be around grateful people, right? And I think you would too, right? So my next question is this. Would you consider yourself as a grateful person? Raise your hands, maybe. Would you consider yourself? Okay. Okay. Make sure you come up to me after service. I would like to hang out with you, spend some time with you, because I like to be around grateful people, right? So, yes, I mean, listen, man, you will find out why it's so important for us to be grateful people as believers in Jesus Christ. But the truth is, grateful people often have a very optimistic view of life, okay? I mean, I've been around grateful people over the years, and I've noticed that the way that they view life is so different. You rarely hear these people complain about things, right? Because they're grateful, right? But the opposite is also true. There are some ungrateful people that we also come across in life. And what you will notice is that these same ungrateful people are very much into complaining, right? They're complaining about how things are not going well for them, how things are not the way it should be. And so, listen, let's be honest. Like, I mean, you've been around people like that too, right? They're not fun to be around. They're very pessimistic, critical, complaining about this and that. I don't have any research to back up my observations, but feel free to reflect on this yourselves to see if this is true from your own experience with people that are grateful and ungrateful, and just compare. Not judge, but just see how things are different between these two types of people, right? And so as we're thinking about the topic of gratefulness or gratitude, I was having a conversation with my wife, and she kind of reminded me of something that happened a while back when my son Landon, our youngest, was younger. I can't remember exactly what age. She had told me that when we used to go to the Dominican Republic short-term missions, this is usually me and my two older boys, right? When they were, you know, able to go. And so every time we would go to the DR, my wife would have special times with Landon. Okay, this is mom and son time, right? And so she was always busy during those times, very much working hard and just very busy. But she would always make time to spend with Landon. And because of the amount of time she spent with him and the things that she was doing for him, he began to develop an attitude of gratitude. Okay? And so he would write her notes to how, saying thankful things to her. And he would put the notes on the night table so that when she would go to bed, she would read them. And she would look forward to reading those notes, right? Because your son has something grateful that he wants to share. And so, listen, kids, it doesn't take too much to make them happy. But just to know that the attitude of gratitude can be developed. And so it got to a point where during this time, Landon decided to write up a coupon book for his mom. In other words, you know what coupons are, right? They're supposed to be used to kind of provide you a discount, you know, things like that. But for Christy's sake, he wrote a coupon book that he would do certain things for her. Like, for example, like maybe give her a massage on her head or do some, you know, cleaning up and things like that. So he would write up a coupon book and give it to her, right? And so when she received the coupon book, of course, that made her really happy, right? But the the funny thing about it, when it's time to redeem those coupons, he actually said it as a joke, but Mom, those coupons expired. And so, I mean, when you hear these stories about kids, you know, and their gratitude, you know, they fluctuate, right? But I'm just so thankful to be reminded of this story. I wasn't privileged or blessed to have experienced it because I was in the DR, but I'm so thankful for Landon, you know, showing appreciation to his mom when he was younger, and he still does that even now. And so this is a personal story that I just share with you, but I want to share with you some stories from God's word that help you to understand the appreciation of people. I want to point to you a story. There are actually two examples. There are many examples of people who were grateful or expressed gratitude in God's word. But I wanted to pinpoint out two stories that are found in the book of Luke. We're going to start with Luke chapter 17. I want to read to you a story about the 10 lepers. And some of you guys are very familiar with the story, right? I'm just going to read this to you and kind of comment on it. We're not going to expound or focus too much on this passage, but I want to read to you beginning with verse 11, Luke chapter 17. You could look up on the overheads. This is what the Word of God says. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go and show yourself to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. In other words, they were healed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. Can you imagine? Praise God, like kind of yelling out loud that he has been healed. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Okay? Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except for this foreigner?" Referring to the Samaritan, okay? And then he said to him, the Samaritan who came to express gratitude, he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." All right, you know, this is a fantastic story about these people. 10 lepers who was healed by God. But you will notice that there was only one. There was only one who expressed gratitude, which leads us to think that the 9 others either were ungrateful or they didn't even bother to give thanks to God. And sometimes we look at ourselves, we look at our own lives. We might be more like the 9 others than we are the Samaritan who came to realize that God has done something so miraculous that he has no choice but to give thanks to him and express gratitude. And the ending of this particular story was so powerful. Jesus not only healed him physically from the leprosy, we get this understanding that he was also forgiven of his sins, because the very words that Jesus says, that your faith has made you well, can also be translated as you have been saved. All right? And so this is a very good example of someone in the scripture that was grateful for what God has done. I want to turn to your attention another passage, which is earlier from the book of Luke, which is found in chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. I'm going to read to you a story about this woman, which they call a sinful woman. This is the passage in Luke chapter 7, verse 36. The Word of God says this: when one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him and at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. Okay? Now, when the Pharisees who had invited him, Jesus, in reference to Jesus, saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. Jesus answered him, oh my, Jesus knew exactly what this guy was thinking, right? He said, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Two people owed money to a certain money lender. One owed him 500 denarii. They say that a denarii is like equivalent to a day's wages, okay? So 500 days of wages. And the other owed 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back. And so the money lender forgave the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Then he turned to the woman and he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. I came in and you did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. This is Jesus speaking to the woman. The other guests began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Listen, brothers and sisters, I am not here to expound this text and give you all the theological framework. I just want to ask you the simple question. Who was the grateful person here? The Pharisee named Simon or the woman who was called the sinful woman? And your conclusion would be very much the woman, right? Because everything she did was an expression of her gratitude. Meanwhile, this Pharisee named Simon, who had everything, had an attitude of self-righteousness. He had a self-righteous attitude by, like, this sinful woman, if you only knew, if you were a prophet, you wouldn't even let this woman touch you like that. An attitude of non-gratitude. That's what Simon had. He didn't realize that he was a sinner himself. He only saw himself as being the righteous one. Sometimes I wonder if we behave in the same way. When we relate to people who don't know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, and we see them behave in certain ways that are so contrary to how we live our lives, our immediate thought is like, man, they're so messed up. And we forget that we were saved by the grace of God. And so let us not cast judgment let us have a heart of gratefulness and attitude that Jesus displayed towards the sinful woman, because the way she expressed it is a real lesson for us all. All right? And so that passage really spoke to me. And when we think about gratitude, we think about many times we face challenges. We experience such difficulties in life. We find it so hard to be thankful. You know, if you're going through a very difficult time, it is almost impossible for you to have an attitude of gratitude. I know, I've been there before. I know that sometimes you experience hardships. You are going through challenges and you find it so hard to thank God for the things that you're going through. And so how can we, as God's people, have an attitude of gratitude in the midst of what we're going through? My answer to that is very simple. We really can't on our own. We really cannot have an attitude of gratitude without the help of God, especially when we have moments in life where we're struggling immensely. But I want to remind you that we live with the Holy Spirit within us. We are believers in Jesus Christ, and God will enable us to have this gratitude even when we're going through difficult times. And so there are people who are experiencing extreme trials in life. They're suffering. But yet God gives them the ability to be thankful in those circumstances. We look at the Apostle Paul. We know that the Apostle Paul experienced so much suffering, persecution. He was beaten. He was flogged. He was experiencing tremendous persecution. And yet, if you read the scriptures and you read the letters he wrote to the various churches, you will know that the apostle displayed a genuine gratitude towards God. That even in the midst of suffering, it was okay. He was able to be content with what he had. And so, you know, today, when we think about what we're going through, you know, the challenges that we're facing, think of the Apostle Paul. Think of Jesus Christ when he was going to the cross. Think about that. Think about when he said to the Father, "Forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." Think about those things. More importantly, we want to bring this closer to home. Think about what Pastor Al just said to us. You think Pastor Al is not suffering? He is. Pastor Al is going through extreme difficulties right now. The voice that you heard is the weakness within him. But yet, there is something that is enabling Pastor Al to have an attitude of gratitude. He is still grateful to the Lord because he knows that his Savior loves him. And his Savior is with him. And his Savior is going to get him through this. And so I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, when you think about hardships and difficulties in life, think of these examples. Think of Pastor Al. And if in case you have nothing to be thankful for, let me share with you some things that you and I can be thankful for. You see, we don't recognize some of these things that we ought to be thankful for. There are times we forget. But let me share with you a couple of things that you and I can be very much thankful for. First and foremost, we have been gifted with life and breath. We have been gifted with life and breath. You have to understand life and breath is a gift from God. And we have it. So be thankful. There's another thing that we have to be thankful for. God has poured out his love, his grace upon us. And through Christ Jesus, his Son, we've been forgiven of our sins. We've been given eternal life in him. And we have been blessed beyond measure. Let me say this again. We have been blessed beyond measure. Because for us who are in Christ, we have every spiritual blessing in him. Some of us are blessed with a great job. You need to be thankful for that. Some of us are blessed with a loving family. You need to be thankful for that. Some of us are blessed with financial wealth. You need to be thankful for that. Some of us have more material possessions. You need to be thankful for that. And the list can go on and on. You see, we forget these things, guys. We often forget them because we take these things for granted, right? But the truth is, we have them. We have life. We have breath. And so instead of being people that are constantly complaining about what we don't have, let's adopt an attitude of gratitude, for that is what God is calling us to. I remember when I was younger, a young teen, at the time when both my parents passed away. Some of you have heard the story before, but I'm going to say it again for those who have not heard it. During those days, I would complain quite a bit. I would complain to my sister, who was my only blood relative at that time. I would complain to her. She was just like a year and a half older than me. As a teen, we're both teens. I would complain to her how unfair life was. You know, I would say to her how I wish what other people had. I would say those things to her. It was almost as if I was telling myself that I deserve what they had. Like the sense of entitlement attitude. I deserve what they have. I deserve what my friends have. I deserve a family like they have. And so I was so convinced that everything surrounding the circumstances in my life, I had nothing to be thankful for. And so I walked around like that with this attitude. And I wallowed in self-pity. You wonder to know how that is like? You'll be surprised when you hang around people who are so ungrateful. But I want to tell you something. I want to tell you that God was at work. He really must have given my sister wisdom and insights into life that I don't even know how she was able to see. She had a perspective that was beyond her age. She had a perspective beyond her age as a teenager. She told me this, Peter, there are many people out there that have less than you have. And many people whose lives are much harder than you are experiencing. And so, in translation, what my sister was essentially saying is that you have food to eat, you have a place to stay, and you have clothes to wear. What more do you want? Okay? You should be happy to have even these things. I don't know how she was able to say those words to me while being so young, but I remember when she spoke to me in those words, I was speechless. I was so convicted. Those words cut to my heart because I knew she was right. I knew she was right in the way that she said those words to me. And I'll never forget those words. I'll never forget those words because she spoke it in such a way where it was God using her to bring some sense into me. Now, I wish I can tell you that my life radically changed from that point forward, but that was not the case. I still had some years to struggle before I came to that realization. So it wasn't until I came to know Christ as my personal Lord and Savior when I began to develop a heart of gratitude. I'm still learning this lesson in life. And so I thank God for my sister, but today I want to encourage you with more words from the scripture from the Apostle Paul. Now, the Apostle Paul spoke to many different churches in Asia Minor, in Macedonia. And I just want to read to you some passages to help you to recognize that the Apostle Paul was exhorting, encouraging the believers in Jesus Christ in the early church to be people that are grateful. I want to start with you from the passage that is found in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19 and 20. All right? This is what it says. Speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so the Apostle Paul right here was encouraging the believers to live a life in such a way where you're speaking to one another in song, in hymns. Sometimes we do that, right? When we're in church. But we need to do this more often when we're not in church, right? Sing to one another songs from the Spirit that comes from your heart. Make music. Always giving thanks. I love the word always giving thanks. It doesn't really tell us sometimes. It says always, guys, right? Always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And, you know, I wish that when we read things like that, we would really take it to heart and start to live it out, right? But more than often, we discover that we're pretty much people that are thankful based on circumstances, right? We're very, like, you know, when things are going well, we're always praising God, right? I want to read to you another passage from Colossians. It's just like almost like a repeat, but this is when the Apostle Paul was instructing the believers in the church in Colossae to live holy lives. And so this is what he said, beginning with verse 15 from chapter 3 of Colossians. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly. What message? Message of the gospel, right? As you teach and admonish one another with wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Again, he's telling them to do this. This is to a different church now. I wonder why he's repeating himself like this, right? Singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. How many of us sing with gratitude in our hearts, right? And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen. Amen. You see, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, let's give thanks to God the Father through Jesus Christ, right? And so this itself should be enough to convince us that God is calling his people to live a life of gratitude. But I want to conclude with another passage. This passage really speaks more personally to me, and I think to you as well. I want to move us into the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5. Okay? I'm going to read to you from verse 16 to 18, and I'm just going to spend a little time explaining this to you. This is what the Apostle Paul said to the church in Thessalonica. Can't pronounce it that well, but you know what I'm talking about. He says, rejoice always. We'll talk about that in a second. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Okay, very simple stuff, guys. Rejoice always. What do you mean, rejoice always? Rejoice always. You see, let me remind you that the joy of the Lord is not based on circumstance. The joy of the Lord comes from the fact that Jesus loved you, died for you, paid for your sins, saved you in order so that you could live a life that glorifies him. And so we cannot allow circumstances to dictate whether our hearts are grateful or not, because your circumstances are bound to be difficult from time to time. All right? So our joy is not based on circumstance. Our joy is based on the Lord Jesus Christ, for he has given us so much. So rejoice always, my brothers and sisters. Pray continually. Okay? What does it mean to pray continually? We need to continue to be in prayer. As God's people, let's be about prayer. How many of you guys pray throughout the day? Some of us do. Some of us just say a quick prayer during our meals. But you know what? We find from Scripture, God is calling his people to pray continually. Unless you read this in such a way where God says pray sometimes when you feel like it. I read this as pray continually, okay? And so the last part in verse 18, which is the climax of this, is that it says, give thanks in all circumstances. Brothers and sisters, what does all circumstances mean? I think you get my point, right? Give thanks in all circumstances. So once again, circumstances don't define our gratitude, but He wants us to give thanks in all circumstances. So I wonder if you and I can give thanks when we're going through very hard times. I wonder. Pastor Al is a living example of that right now. He's modeling it for us. You need to understand, he is going through physical suffering, but in his heart, there is a gratitude. There is a sense of knowing that God is with him. And so the scripture tells us that when we are weak, God is strong. And so God is strong for Pastor Al. He's helping him through this process. So give thanks, my brothers and sisters, in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. For this is God's will. For this is God's will. It is not my will. It isn't your will. It's God's will. It's God's will for you who are in Christ to be grateful people. And so how can we do this? You know, we find ourselves like having such a hard time, right? I want to give you three ways that we can be grateful. Three ways that we can express our gratitude. The one way that we can start by doing is we got to focus on the goodness of God. We just simply have to focus on the goodness of God. We need to recall the goodness of God in our lives. So start with a focus on God's goodness. All right? Then move to the next one, which is to count your blessings. All right? We know that song. Count your blessings, right? One by one. Some of us have forgotten to count our blessings. You know, the fact that we're able to get from point A to point B without any incident, isn't that a blessing? The fact that we make it to work safely, the fact that we make it to school safely, I mean, isn't that a blessing, guys? Can you count that as a blessing? Right? Count your blessings. Count your blessings. You have food on the table. You have a place where you have a roof over your head and you have clothes to wear. That's a blessing from God. Some people don't have those things. All right? So count your blessings. Count them one by one. And then last but not least, this is almost like a recurring theme, right? Romans 8:28 says this, right? God works all things together for good to those who love him. God works all things together for good. And so if you're going through some challenging, difficult, and times of suffering, remember, there is a purpose behind this suffering. God is at work, and he promised that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And so I just want you to be encouraged by that. You know, after coming to know Christ as my Lord and Savior, God had to do some work in my heart in such a way where some transformation needed to take place. So when God was at work in my heart, I started to focus, instead of focusing on the things I didn't have, God would remind me of the things I had, all right? And so that is a Holy Spirit time of, like, just renovating areas of my life that was broken, right? I learned to be thankful for the things that I have. It's a lesson, guys. It's a lesson in life too, right? And the truth is, I may not have a lot in terms of finances or material possessions, but I do have God. I have God. I have a wonderful and loving family. I have a loving community that God has blessed me with, the church. And Christ, I've been blessed beyond measure. You see, this is a win-win for me. It's a win-win. And for that, I am eternally grateful. And I hope that you are as well. Just because we have a lot, it does not mean that we're grateful people. I know some of us have probably met people that have a lot. But look at their lives, man. Sometimes it's like they're kind of like living miserably. Some people who have a lot are not necessarily going to appreciate and enjoy and be grateful for what they have. Some people. I'm not saying all. Some people. Right? So church, I want you to know that life will be so different if we start walking around with an attitude of gratitude. Can I say this again? life will be so much different if we start to walk around with an attitude of gratitude. And I'll tell you why. Because not only are we going to honor God in the process, but our health is going to improve. And you're wondering, wow, how is that possible, right? Guess what? When we complain less, we will feel better. Trust me. Trust me in this, okay? Our anxiety levels will start to decrease because you start to appreciate things. Your anxiety levels start to decrease, right? You're going to worry less because the time that you would spend on worrying will be focused on God, counting your blessings, and giving thanks to Him. Amen to that? And what's more, our lives become a living testimony to others. You know, if you're a grateful person, you talk about how grateful you are and how you point them to God in the process, there's going to be a testimony for you. There's going to be people who are going to look at you. Wow, what is it that this person, what is it that he has? What is it that she has? I want some of that. That's a testimony, guys. And God can do that in you. And so I want to encourage you with these words as we close in a song of response. I want us to think about this, guys. I want us to think about this. God is calling us to be thankful in all circumstances because that's God's will for us in Christ Jesus. Amen? Christ in me, in us, is the hope of glory. And so we want to glorify God by living a life of gratitude so that people will know that Jesus is indeed for real. Amen, church? Let's pray. Father, we come before you to thank you, God, for your word to us today. We acknowledge, oh God, that oftentimes in our lives we struggle to be thankful and grateful. Some of us feel like it's a struggle immensely because we're going through difficult times. We can't even see what we can be thankful for. But Lord, you remind us over and over that we have been blessed and we've been gifted with life and breath. We have been blessed beyond measure because of what you have done. You have poured out your grace. You have poured out your love on us, God. You have died in order so us to be saved. And God, you have blessed us with so many things in life. Help us never to take those things for granted. Help us to always be people that appreciate for what we have. I pray, Lord, that when we walk out of this place, we will be rejuvenated with an attitude of gratitude. Help us, by your Holy Spirit, give us the means and the grace to do so, so that we might bring you glory, and so that our lives will be a living testimony to others that you are indeed God of all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you please rise? Sometimes I fail, still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond. Losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond the
heart and my soul. Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Justice.